Welcome to Your Story, everybody. Today we have an esteemed panel that's going to discuss contactless payments in a post-pandemic world. I've got some senior individuals who are going to tell you what has happened during the COVID, how digital adoption has increased, digital transformation has happened. I've got with me Mahesh Ramamurthy, Managing Director, Banking Solutions, International Market, APAC at FIS. I've got Sunil Kulkarni, Director, FinTech Advisory, Alamac Capital. I've got Amitabh Tiwari, Chief Innovation Officer at Razorpay, and I've got Karthik Raghupathy, VP Strategy and Business Development at PhonePe. Hello, everybody. Today's discussion is going to be fantastic because there are 50 million SMBs out there, about 900 million people who want to go contactless. I think India has the best fintech platforms in the world, and we're going to discuss how that's changing the country and the world globally with technology. So Mahesh, I'm going to begin with you. The pandemic has, has spurred this contactless movement. There's increased usage in a lot of things, contactless payments for SMBs. So what are some of the challenges that these SMBs have to tackle if they have to use contactless?
So I think it's a great start, I think, to the way we're going to discuss. To me, I think the pandemic, contactless is always there, right? It is always existing. It was a technology that probably has been well adopted. And now we've had that opportunity to take it to the fore. So when you look at contactless today, whether it is using the standard QR code, which is static, or whether you have NFC-based applications or you have various other opportunities that are now emerging, I think the good part of the way I look at things is that we've seen a lot of the technology companies, fintech companies coming, adopting it, integrating it into their entire customer experience scenarios, right? That's most important, whether you have the panelists here who really engage at the B2C, or it's all about how the ease of transactions and more importantly, the security of the transactions, right? Having said that, to me, I think we've just scratched the tip of the iceberg. But when you shift, when you step back and look at it, today for the SMB business, I think it's all about how you're going to enable adoption and enable from an acquiring point of view, how are you going to enable to the larger mass? And and we all know that there is a huge potential in India from a 900 plus million in terms of the opportunity size. And from an SMB perspective, we've probably just scratched the surface. So in my opinion, I think what's very important is, what is it that I always believe in three things that any business would like to understand this. One is in terms of the experience that they provide, so the adoption is better. Two is in terms of the security, the secure layer, because today a lot of the clients or the B2C, the C part of this, are probably averse to using it unless and until they are knowing that it's going to be a secure transaction. Otherwise, there is a very high rate of possibly tapping it away and using that transaction without your... The third one is all about when you have the acquiring challenges and the infrastructure on the front end, I think we still have to cover that, because at the end of the day, when there is the merchant who's supposed to get the money, it is all about the ease of that settlement process and the end-to-end value chain that supports this kind of a transaction base. I think today we are looking at one part of the story. The whole ecosystem is still missing, end-to-end game plan. I think that end-to-end game plan is very critical. So for us to enable SMBs, it is about how a lot of the players come together. Now, we can be competitive in our spaces, but at the end of the day, how are we going to make it accessible, enhance the reach? How does the government and regulators really enable some of these transactions? And more importantly, create the kind of secure layer that allows folks to be able to accept it, right? So to me, I think it's a great opportunity, huge untapped potential. New forms of opportunity that will come up in the, with all the innovation coming in. So to me, yes, it's next 18 months will redefine how payments are made. And I would say that for SMBs, it's all about increasing the acquiring presence. And in terms of making sure that from a merchant perspective, how quickly they're going to get the money into their account, and what is the seamless way of managing disputes. I think these are some areas, if we are able to solve for, we will probably see the transactions growing, I would say, at least 3x in the next 18 months. That's the way I look at it.
I want to quickly bring in Amitabh and Karthik here, because you know, they obviously have a lot of SMEs and small retailers that work with them. Amitabh, a quick note on what Mahesh said. Would you agree with this hypothesis? And I think I would agree with him, but there is massive opportunity in terms of scale, right? Amitabh, quickly on Razorpay's point of view, and then I'll move on to PhonePe and then move on to Sunil.
No, surely. In fact, you know, what you've asked, you know, Vishal, that's like a pretty big topic, and one can
go on and on
about it, but, you know, only to talk about two or three specific areas. Look, in the pandemic, post-pandemic world, I think SMBs were the hardest hit. You know, when you have limited working capital, very low margin for error, when you have to make sure that every single business cycle that you are participating in gives you the right kind of return, because there is very little reserve, so to say, right? Then this kind of, you know, a circumstance which you find yourself in, which you've not planned for, which nobody in the world has planned for, hits you the hardest, right? You are in, you're that link in the whole ecosystem. So SMBs, obviously, they are identified with nimbleness. They're quick to, you know, sort of find their, figure their way out of situations. And therefore, you know, the first big problem that the SMBs had to contend with was how to deal with the fact that the customer is not stepping out of, you know, their homes and offices. So, which means that you have to take your shop or your business establishment, your, I would say, shopping cart or your, you know, whatever you have, you know, to their doorstep. You have to take, you know, the shopping experience to your customer's home and office. That was the first, you know, challenge that SMBs faced, which, you know, converted into a solution mindset means digitization. You got to digitize, right? It was no longer a choice, and therefore SMBs who were purely offline, they became hybrid. They they quickly built their online presence. The second, you know, amongst the many other challenges that they faced, one was how do you collect payments effectively, and actually how do you manage your money effectively? So how do you collect payment from those who owe it to you? And this could be, you know, symptomatic of a supply chain where a distributor has to collect payments from, let's say, the retailer, or, you know, further down the chain, you know, where a, you know, seller has to collect it from a buyer. The challenge that that they faced was that all of a sudden the means of payments that were adopted earlier had become less favorable, right? People were, I mean, earlier, you, let's say you go to a restaurant, you would not mind giving your card to the restaurant guy for settling your bill, right? There were some people who were a little careful about it. So, you know, they would probably, you know, walk up to, let's say, the cashier's counter to enter their PIN, etc. But there were instances where your card would be out of your sight, right? Where it would leave your hand and would be out of your sight. There, the concern was more about the safety and security of your finances. Correct. Suddenly, that changed to your own safety and security, right? Now, you were not very keen to accept cash because, you know, that would impact your safety, or write a check. So, businesses had to deal with the problem or the challenge of accepting, you know, payments remotely or in a non-contact, contactless kind of fashion, right? And that's where I think the big opportunity for growth for contactless has come. I mean, something which was already happening in a small, in a slow manner, has got massively accelerated, as if it's, you know, it's on you know, it's on steroids, right? For want of a better you know, metaphor. So suddenly, you know, what would probably have happened over 3 years or 4 years or 5 years with multiple regulatory interventions, with habit change, has got accelerated to a point where whether it is a transaction where the user or the buyer is physically present himself or herself, or whether it is done, you know, done remotely, I would club all of them as contactless payments. Suddenly, you know, these have found an impetus. And I believe what it has brought to the fore is that these transactions or these payment methods are inherently secure, safe, probably more advanced. It's just that there were not enough use cases, or if it ain't broken, why fix it kind of a scenario, right?
Other we'll get into the security aspects of it, because that's, it's a very important aspect that I want to cover. Quickly, Karthik, from your case, PhonePe's growth over the last 9 months, phenomenal. A lot of the Kiranas are using it. But what are the challenges in terms of the consumer side and the B2B side for you?
Yeah, I think let me just echo a couple of points, but also just add on a couple of things I wanted to mention. I think like Mahesh mentioned, we are at the cusp of transformation, but I think this is a transformation that India has already seen before. It's almost like the telecom revolution. I think the digital payment transformation is also just similar just to what we saw 10, 15 years ago with the telecom revolution. Literally anyone with a smartphone or even maybe in the future with a feature phone should be able to access digital payments. So whether you're a consumer or a merchant, digital payments is going to become ubiquitous or as ubiquitous as a cell phone. So that's one meta point. I think when we look forward the next 10 years, that's literally what we will experience as all of us in India, as consumers and as merchants. The second thing is this notion of contactless, I think is a fairly broad word. So I just wanted, it's a minor point, but I think it's an important point. You know, typically when people think of interacting with merchants, they think of the QR code or they think of NFC. Yeah. But when you think of, you know, a use case like PhonePe or any payment app interacting with a merchant, you can literally sit and do the payment at home. Now, we saw a lot of that happening as, you know, the country opened up. The merchants were open. The consumers were at home. They didn't necessarily go to the merchant's shop and then scan a QR code. They literally just paid the merchant from home, right? And many of us have enabled that kind of payment where you don't have to go to the store and have a QR code. The store is visible on your app, on the PhonePe app, for example, and then you just pay them from home. And then you chat with them either through the PhonePe chat or WhatsApp chat or whatever it is, and then you get the stuff delivered. So that's something that we've seen, you know, uniquely happening in the COVID times because people don't necessarily go to the store. I think the third point I want to make is digitization or digital payments is just the foundation. When you think about the consumer merchant ecosystem, there are multiple things that need to be built on top of digital payments. You have to think about discovery, helping users discover merchants nearby. You have to give the ability for merchants to be able to contact these consumers. So, you know, you're a local bakery, you want to contact a few consumers near you, telling them about a sale that you have this Sunday. That's something you need to enable. You need to be able to give them catalogs, khata book. There's a whole bunch of services that you need to layer on top of payments, which is when Kirana has become truly digitized. And I think that's where the really exciting opportunity lies for India.
I think that's a good segue into Sunil's questions because Mahesh, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, you know, it's a good point that Karthik also made. It's about, yeah. It's about not just about enabling payments, but it's about enabling the value. And once you create that value for an end consumer, I think the adoption rate becomes higher. And he explained a very, very subtly and very beautifully in terms of how the Kirana stores are getting enabled. And that's the next big wave where you see so many new entities jumping into that. To me, you know, that also really reflects in some of the surveys that we have done in terms of the acceptance of payments and digital payments. There's a pulse survey of saying that's going to be the game changer. To me, I think it's not going to be just about creating the large retailers. It's about bringing the small retailers into the value system, and the value chain is going to make that big difference now. So one big thing you've seen that when you are pre-pandemic, we used to only visit malls. Post-pandemic, right. We are happy to even just walk across or just use the nearest shop to get what you like, right? Yes. So that's a big shift that you've done yourself. And look at your own purchasing or what you want. You've rationalized it to see what's the best way you can get it done without creating much of human touch. I think that's what you have to really now enable them.
I completely agree with the three of you. It's become, we are creating micro communities, you know, micro geographies with contactless, right? I mean the innovation. Whoever thought that there'll be something called the contactless pickup? I thought COD was innovative enough. But contactless pickup is something that we talk about, and that's an amazing innovation too. So then on that note, right, there's an important aspect that the four of them have covered, and I think you can weigh upon this. You know, India, the digital divide. India has many countries and many things, and certainly there's a digital divide, right? So, you know, in terms of adoption from the urban poor side to the tier two, tier three cities and the villages even, right? I know Razorpay and PhonePe has been used in smaller towns as well. But if you have to really make this a democratic kind of approach, sociologically speaking, what would be the approach that you would see? What is going to happen? I like what Karthik said. If you provide value to the customer, he's going to adopt it. It's going to be seamless, right? So what are your thoughts?
Yeah. So I think I'll talk about two, three things that
Karthik, please.
Amitabh touched upon. First of all, we touched upon the telecom revolution. And yes, telecom started with pager or landline, and from landline to pager, and then pager to mobile. So in US, there were at least 3-4 years that the pager existed. And in India, only after 1 year, we leapfrogged from landline to mobile. Similar thing is happening now on digital payments. The only difference is that, you know, we had earlier a point of sale terminal. Post demonetization, we had a mobile POS, which was, I mean, point of sale terminal was say 10,000 rupees. A mobile POS was around 5,000 rupees. And now we are leapfrogging to what we call it as soft POS. So telecom revolution and digital payment revolution are also following similar this thing that I'll talk about business case because there is enough being talked about user experience. The business case for soft POS or for that matter digital payment is a direct function of what is the cost available at merchant outlet. And if somebody is being charged 500 rupee per month rental for a traditional POS or a 200 rupee per month for a mobile POS, this is only currently giving only 5 million POS in the country out of 50 million SMEs or MSMEs we are talking about. So soft POS is going to take this particular number from 5 million to easily 15 or 20 million, simply because it is not going to cost even if you use contact and contactless with the soft POS, it's not going to cost more than 1,500 rupees to 1,700 rupees as a capex compared to the 10,000 rupees. And from that perspective, suddenly the entire infrastructure of payments, be it QR, be it biometric, be it contact, or be it contactless, will become viable for a merchant. That's the first part I wanted to say. The second part was what Karthik was talking about is what we call as a non-face-to-face transaction. So a non-face-to-face transaction is not strictly speaking contactless transaction. It is actually a non-face-to-face transaction. A contactless transaction is probably you do it with, let's say, QR code on a face-to-face or using tokenized mobile with NFC or with a card with another NFC. Now that's where, as you talked about India and Bharat, August, RBI released a guideline which said that below 200 rupee contactless payment, we will allow, if it is through EMB, which is Visa, MasterCard, RuPay, we will allow no connectivity back to your backend server. See, today, every transaction, whether you use PIN or no PIN, even in contactless or QR code, calls for authorization from the backend. This is the first time if you are having a transaction below 200 rupee, up to cumulative 2000 rupee, you don't have to call back your server to authorize. That means there is a stored value available at the card, whether it could be a tokenized mobile or a contactless card, which in RuPay they call it as NCMC card, National Common Mobility Card. And it could potentially be also all Google Pay, Phone Pay with tokenization will enable, where below 200 rupee, you go to any location, you tap, and these are all micro transactions we are talking. The moment we do these micro transaction enable, what the merchant wants? Merchant is not really interested in the exotic payments. Merchant is interested in the money. Now, if that is being authorized, the total time taken for a contactless offline payment is equal to what you do on mass rapid transit, which is less than 3 seconds, yes, or 4 seconds. Today, our contactless payments or any other payment take between 20 seconds to 30 seconds. Now, the moment you make it available, then it is very, very clear that the contactless payment will take off in a big way, whether it is urban or India or whether it is suburban or Bharat, that we will see a mass proliferation of payment as we speak.
And are the technologies ready for this? Some people talk about edge computing. You spoke about NFC. And you know that's where the security issue comes in. Also, we'll get into that. But are the technologies ready at this point of time? And you know, from here, I want to segue into Karthik and Amitabh, and Mahesh can probably add in about financial literacy and financial inclusion too. Karthik, I know you raised your hand. You could say, Sunil, please, can you answer that question before we move on?
Karthik. So in terms of technology, it is ready. I'm currently also advising few initial and growth state fintech startups. So as we speak, we are in the stage of enabling the August 2020 RBI guidelines so that it becomes a norm and not a trial for this purpose, because everybody is wanting payment to happen in a jiffy. And that can only happen if we are able to enable micropayment with sub 5 second transit time.
That is fantastic. And if it happens, I think we should be exporting this technology globally. It's an Indian product, and that's a fantastic thing. Karthik, you were saying something. And to you, I'll also, to the point you add, maybe you want to include later on financial inclusivity, financial literacy in this country. And, you know, there are so many connectivity issues that you had to handle with Kiranas, right?
Yeah.
How do we solve for those things, please? And this is open to Amitabh also and Mahesh, please.
Let me cover both in the same way.
Yeah.
I think our experience on India Bharat inclusivity has been that it's been a pan-India adoption.
Yeah.
We cover it on three aspects. And a typical company like us covers, touches three parts in our ecosystem: consumers, merchants, and the BFSI sector, the banking sector,
correct,
which is where money comes from.
Yes.
Now, if you start on the consumer side, all of us, whether it's us or our competitors, we've all collectively, I think, gotten in about 250 to 300 million Indians into the digital payment ecosystem.
Correct.
Now, that by itself is about half of the smartphone penetration in India, right? And when you actually think about user base, and I can speak to ours, more than 70% of our users come from tier two and below. And it's across 19,000 pin codes. So we actually already see a pan-India adoption on the user side. And if you think about our explicit objective over the next couple of years, and we publicly announced this as well, is we've set ourselves a target to get to 500 million users from the current 250 million users in the next 2 years. So absolutely a pan-India phenomenon, already seeing that as a trend, and we continue to kind of grow in that dimension. On the SME or merchant side, we have 13 million SMEs today that accept PhonePe, or Kiranas that accept, majority of whom are Kiranas. So in a way, to use Sunil's word, these are POS devices. I mean, these are point of sale acceptance devices. A QR code is also, of course, you know, depending on the QR code or depending on the point of sale device, you may accept certain types of instruments, but the merchant is able to accept money that is not cash. You already have 13 million. We expect to go to 25 million by end of next year. And like our CEO Sameer recently mentioned, I think the instructions to our Salesforce is quite clear. If there's a Parleji biscuit, then we want to be there. Or a Parleji biscuit plus a telco connection, we want to be there as a payment acceptance solution. So I think we already see a significant adoption across India. And you don't get to such numbers unless you're in the small towns, in villages, in rural areas. And the adoption has been phenomenal. In fact, just a factoid, when the country opened up first back in April or May, when we had this concept, green zones and, you know, red zones, a lot of the activity we saw was actually in really small towns, which were all green. The metros were all still red. And all the green zones is where we saw all the activity picking up. And, you know, that wouldn't have happened unless the adoption is already there.
Okay.
And the last point I want to make is on the BFSI sector.
Yeah,
when you think about people kind of transacting on, you know, sending money to each other or, you know, paying bills. What's also very interesting is the opportunity to penetrate financial services, mutual funds and insurance into both consumers and merchants on the back of this digital payment adoption. So I think there's a lot of excitement in terms of this whole ubiquitous adoption of payments in India, but it's got the ability to foray into SME growth using digitization, but also into financial services penetration.
So are you saying that that all of you have worked hard enough to actually make sure that people are informed that people know what this means. People know what a PhonePe is. People know what a RazorPay is. So there is some kind of financial literacy today to use these kind of apps, would you say? And how will that lead to inclusivity in a country where bandwidth and connectivity issues still remain?
See, I think as long as there's a 4G connection, it's fine. And if you think about India's 4G consumption, we're already highest per capita. Now, that doesn't happen unless you have decent infrastructure. And I think all of us, right, whether it's us or, you know, the telco operators, we're all working towards digitizing our ability, giving access to Indians to just the internet. Mm-hmm. Now, if you think about inclusivity, I think, again, already seeing enough proof points that it's working. So, again, I'll just give you an example. We've been launching insurance and mutual funds products quite rapidly in the beginning of this year. More than 60% of these products, our insurance and mutual funds products, come from what we call B30, beyond 30. So the government has a classification of top 30 and then beyond 30, and there is a terminology called B30. More than 60% of our insurance and mutual fund customers are from B30. And that's a huge ability to, you know, opportunity to penetrate financial services into Bharat. And so I don't think it's a future. I think it's actually already present. It's just about scaling it up.
Absolutely. And we'll talk about the issues of scaling up. You've also mentioned some in a bit. Mahesh, you wanted to add something. And Amitabh, the same question to Karthik is open to you too. Mahesh, please.
So I think, you know, I'm just going to reiterate just a quick one in terms of, you know, whatever surveys that we have done, you know, in terms of the pulse surveys or the other surveys that we've really said, it's all about, you know, about the ability of how you're able to get the customer experience. And I use the word customer experience because when you, you know, you've been, Karthik was mentioning about adoption and you talked about adoption. It's all going to be, you know, smartphone penetration is increasing by the day. Everyone's replacement is coming with a smartphone, whether it is small, entry level or whatever. Now, the connectivities are fairly stable. I would say it, we covered about 60-70% of the country is still fairly stable.
Yes.
It's all about the experience that you get, right? It's experience. When I say experience, it's all about saying in your local language, in your language that you could understand, and how simply can you just go about doing the transaction and you get a confirmation which is saying, you know, it's your transaction, I'm good with it. So I think those areas of how we can enable not just the tier one, but tier three, tier four customers to use the digital transactions in a way that they will be more comfortable with is going to be a big big shift for us.
Okay.
I think, you know, and that's going to start expanding because your inclusivity is going to then expand your footprint of what all you do. You know, and I would say eventually in a few years it'll become all pervasive. There'll be some new technology, new things coming in, which will start changing the whole game plan.
That is sure. And I'd like to hear Razorpay's point of view, right? Amitabh, I mean, the smallest of towns, smallest of businesses, say traders in probably outside of Kanpur in the tannery industry, maybe a lot of people are using Razorpay, I hear. And obviously, you can give us such examples, right? When we talk about financial inclusivity, you could talk about some small town adoption in terms of business. And please go on about that.
Yeah. So, I mean, what I'm going to start off by saying is may sound a little indulgent, but of late, you know, whenever people reach out and they talk about their experience of online payments, I receive calls out of the blue from people who, let's say, have not been in touch with for 6 months or so, and they say, "Hey, Amitabh, I made an online transaction and it was on Razorpay." So, you know, with a certain amount of glee in their voices. Yes, the penetration without any doubt has clearly been into tier two, probably into tier three also, but I would stop there and, you know, just reflect on it a little bit more. First and foremost, I mean, there are two points I want to make. One, not all Bharat is below affluence micropayment, right? There is a Bharat which also buys Mercedes cars, 108 delivered on the same day, you know, so there is that Bharat that exists. While there is also an India in the big cities, which is actually scraping at the bottom of the barrel, right? So I would like to look at it more as, like Sunil rightly said, micropayments versus large ticket payments, let's say for discretionary, you know, use items. That's one. Secondly, this whole talk about connectivity, etc. So let me use something like a parallel, you know, penetration of, let's say, WhatsApp or Google into or Facebook into the Indian hinterland, right? All of these, you know, whether you talk about social media, whether you talk about a social networking app, they all need connectivity. And today, if you talk to anybody from these companies, they'll tell you that their penetration is right up to, you know, category EF, you know, into the villages. Now, if there is bandwidth available for people to stay in touch, there would be bandwidth for making payments also. May not be predictable, always available, stable bandwidth. But for, you know, it's not that it's a complete blackout for 24 hours. Having said that, that's something which will get taken care of gradually. Let's not, I mean, honestly, I would like to be more realistic about it. I think it will take time for us as a country to cover all of our landmass, and we are a really big and diverse country, and it will take time for us and to cover all the areas, all the parts, all the geographical, you know, divisions of India with proper, reliable, always on connectivity, 4G level. It will take time, right? But while that happens, and I don't think anybody is expecting, digitization of payments to happen overnight. What we have achieved probably in the last 5 years is what we achieved in the first 50 years or so, right? So it's the pace which is important, is the direction that you're taking which is more important. And as Razorpay, we are very confident about it. Mm-hmm. We are a six-year-old company, you know, and honestly speaking, the adoption of whatever new we have launched and our sweet spot or the target, you know, customer persona that we have in mind is that of an SMB. Whenever we have launched a new product, be it an adjacent product like lending solutions or early settlements, or let's say a neo banking service for managing your payroll well or managing your vendor payouts well, we've seen very quick adoption. Now, of course, I mean, this is on the back of customers who we already serve for our payment gateway service. But the point I was trying to make was a predominantly, small, medium enterprise customer segment also very quickly adapts to new solutions, so long as it solves the problem for them, right? Creates value for them. Now, there is no silver bullet or there is no magic way for all of these different components of the payment ecosystem to come together and keep pace with each other. Typically, what happens is acquiring first builds. So merchants show the willingness to start accepting digital payments. Customers then realize that, okay, there are incentives to be made, or there is some other motivation for them to start using the digital payments. And that's how slowly it builds brick by brick and then, assumes a certain amount of momentum. The point I was trying to make earlier also is COVID and some of these completely unprecedented kind of, circumstances that we find ourselves in have created the sort of momentum which I have at least not seen in my, 2-3 decades, that I have been either following digital payments or working in this space. This is something unprecedented. And what I believe is that whether it's micropayments, by the way, talking about technology, if you go about 10 years back, at that time, most payments anyways used to be offline. There was no concept of online payments in India, at least, right? So you would go to a petrol bunk, you would use your card, and that transaction never used to get settled. It used to be batch processing, right? So the same thing probably needs to be revisited with a slightly different kind of, risk assessment mindset. But point I'm making is, yes, the adoption is for sure going to be there. We have already seen that. We have seen evidences of that happening. Secondly, Bharat will adopt digital payments fairly quickly. Faster. It's just that there will be sections of that society which will do that, right? Which are probably, and for the rest of them, we will need to come up with new solutions as the infrastructure advances and keeps, becomes more stable and reliable. We will need to have, products and solutions.
Yeah. Then you'll certainly like this because Amitabh, thanks for that. But you said different societies, and that's a very important point, which I'm going to take to Sunil now. Sunil, the AP government has recently launched a QR code based system for direct benefit transfer, right? I mean, it's not as if in this country we are ignoring a certain section of the population. We are trying to be inclusive, and fintech is certainly inclusive in our country at this point of time. Like Amitabh said, what we couldn't do for 50 years, we've probably done it in the last 10 years. Of 5 years even, right? What are your thoughts on that? What more needs to be done from the government and the private sector perspective?
Yeah, so first, just to talk what just
mentioned,
for digital payments, you do not need 4G.
Okay.
I have done in my company, which I was running earlier, Oxygen, biometric payments on GPRS. Mm-hmm. So you can do biometric payments on GPRS and you don't need 4G for that. The fundamental challenge with connectivity is an end-to-end transaction. And the corner case actually take away the customer. So you want to do a 500 rupee transaction, your bank account has been debited, and suddenly the connectivity stops. And the transaction is not authorized back at the merchant end. What is merchant supposed to do? Will he give the goods or will he not give the goods? So that is where I think they say, okay, if it is not that good, let me just switch to cash. It is nothing to do with 2G, 3G, 4G, or even 5G. Today, in terms of the example that we are talking about, WhatsApp being 400 million subscribers plus and Facebook and all that, these are not the transactions where we are exchanging currency. Here we are exchanging currency, and therefore definity of the transaction is very important. The transaction is either successful or it has failed. If it is anything in between, you are taking away customer from using that that particular payment later on. And that is why I talked about the offline transaction, which is being talked about for micropayments, etc. Now, coming to the AP government's initiative, see, whether we use QR code or we use the contactless payment or cards or Aadhaar Pay for that matter, what is more important is the financial literacy or awareness with the customer that, you know, his money is safe. It is, see, there are 2 billion transactions that have happened on UPI, but even the smallest of the small fraud comes as a headline on newspaper.
Yeah.
Now compare that to the total amount of good transactions that have happened on UPI, which will not come. It will come once in a month as a statistics, but every small little fraud will come as a big headline. And what happens is, these are also, many of the transactions are online transactions. Talking about numbers, we are talking about 850 million debit cards, which means there are 850 million bank accounts, out of which, let's say, 500 million have smartphones. Out of 500 million smartphones, if we talk about monthly active users of PhonePe or Google Pay or Amazon Pay or Paytm, all the four big ones, it will not exceed between 100 to 150 million. People will have different claims. So monthly active user has remained between 100 to 150 million. But what happens to balance 350 million smartphones who are using Google, who are using WhatsApp, who are using Facebook? So that's where trust on payment for a face-to-face transaction also needs to come. And that is what contactless will do. Because what will happen is, if there is any failure in payment, at least I can catch. When there is a failure in payment on Google Pay, can you catch Google? You can't. So that's how the trust on payment needs to come, and which can come by financial literacy and awareness of how an online payment is different than a face-to-face. I would say even face-to-face is now online payment. There's no offline payment per se. It is just the terminology we had, what Amitabh said. 10 years back, the payment, you know, at petrol pump was an offline payment because batch processing was happening, and even authorization used to happen later on. But now every transaction is actually an online transaction. We are talking about face-to-face transaction and non-face-to-face transaction to replace the terminology called online and offline payment, because every payment is now online payment. So once the initiative like these take place, where financial literacy of how the transaction can be more secure, in fact, I would say digital transactions are more secure than cash. You know, a fake currency you can't notice, but there is no fake transaction. You can't have a fake transaction, but you can have a fake currency. So when you are exchanging notes, you can actually be exchanging a fake note, you don't know. But a fake transaction cannot happen because everything is being authorized. So from that perspective, a digital transaction is far more secure, but that awareness needs to come. And as you are bringing more transaction, as Karthik was mentioning about insurance, credit, mutual fund, lending, you are building a profile of the next 300 or 400 million customers on credit worthiness. And that's how the economy can grow, when you are having credit available for taking the economy to the next level. So this is very, very important.
I agree with you. And I want to throw this question to Karthik and Amitabh, and Mahesh can add in also. This changes the relationship between me as a citizen, my relationship with the government and financial institutions. Right, Karthik, with the amount of creditworthy data, I'm getting new credit history as a Kirana store. Right, I'm getting new credit history as an SMB by using PhonePe or a RazorPay. Right, that fundamentally changes the dynamic on how you approach, you know, subsidies from the government, you know, how you work with your suppliers, ecosystem. You know, where is that heading? I mean, you guys are almost studying consumer behavior. Are they appreciative that we are heading in that direction? This is almost like an intellectual debate at this point of time, right? And it's a matter of time we get there. But how appreciative are people into this convergence that's happening in the market at this point? Karthik?
I think, Sunil, you're absolutely right. A number of bank accounts is somewhere in the 850, 900 million. Smartphones is about 550, 600 million. And I think monthly active users of a lot of us, all of us payment, mobile payment users, right, is probably in the range of 150 million. Mm-hmm. And I think there is a big, but the important point is, a year ago, that number, that 150 million was probably 50 million. And 2 years ago, there was 5 million. So it is growing at the rate of knots. And I think, yes, as we go further and further into India, one of the key enablers would be trust and security. And I think we have to educate a lot of users around how safe it is, how digital payments is very safe. But I think that's just, and Amitabh talked about, I think it's just part of the journey. It's just a question of when. It's not a question of if. And I think absolutely India, 5 years from now, will be 3x, 4x, 5x of these numbers. Now, with regards to what role we have or players like us have, I think there's a few roles that we play, right? The first is we all are part of growing the market. It's not about market share and getting a slice of the pie. It's actually about growing the pie. I think we all are now large enough, whether it's us or any of the folks here or other people in the competitive ecosystem. Innovation and competition is a good thing. And I think we're all growing that pie for India, growing the number of digital payment users and the financial literacy on the back of that. That's certainly one role and one responsibility we have at our scale. I think the second responsibility is on protection of consumer privacy. I think whether it's data or consumer privacy, that is something that I think it should be core to any of us, especially those of us who play at scale. And that's not something that we should compromise at any point. So, businesses that are built with the compromise that you're going to use that data to, give to somebody else, that's just, I don't think that works at scale and, you're going to compromise consumer privacy. I think these two responsibilities, both in terms of overall growing the pie, while balancing the consumer privacy and also making sure consumers have trust, is something that all scale players have as a responsibility. Right? So I don't think we can shy away from it.
Fascinating point. And that's Amitabh. So if you can add the security bit, you were talking about it briefly. I want you to touch upon it in detail. What measures have you taken? I mean, what measures can, startups take to actually ensure, like Karthik said, protect consumer data while making it easy to use? You've got to ensure that, like Sunil mentioned, right? You cannot let one bad apple spoil the entire good news out there. Right? Go on.
Sure. No, absolutely, Vishal. And frankly, banking is all about trust. I think banking, financial services, somebody entrusting their money with you, either in a deposit account or in transit, they need to trust you. That trust has to be not just in the entities, but the ecosystem overall, right? And therefore, you are only as good as the weakest link in the ecosystem. If you say that I'm doing my job well, but somewhere there is a leakage, that's too bad and that's not good enough for the customer to repose their faith in you. Luckily for us, I think, we have been evolving an ecosystem. I would not say so much on the data privacy side yet, although we have taken first few, I think, definitive steps in that direction. But on the safety security aspect, for sure. In fact, India probably was ahead of some of the other developed markets. If you look at the safety and security aspect of transactions, some of it, in fact, coming at the cost of consumer convenience also. Maybe because given the nature of, the diverse or the pretty heterogeneous kind of, customers that we have in our country, at one end of the spectrum, you will have someone who has seen the world and is pretty, aware of everything that needs to be done for responsible transactions. But on the other hand, you also have people who trust others with their, passwords and their OTPs and stuff like that. So therefore, sometimes we had to adopt security measures, which probably were a bit overbearing, a bit intrusive, but nevertheless, we have coped with that and we have grown well despite all of that. Just to, everybody in the panel here is obviously well versed with it, but for the sake of those who will be watching this, this discussion, let me just quickly summarize why an online payment ecosystem, or let's say transactions that you do, any payment transaction that you do, using all the approved instruments, why those are safe. All payment transactions follow a very high level of security in terms of encryption of the data that flows at the time of the transaction, in terms of how the consumer data is stored, in terms of the credentials or the instruments, whether it's a card or a UPI handle. So the storage, the transmission of data, and at every single step, you know, how that data is handled, everything is done with very high standards of security. If you look at the leaks that have happened, if you look at data leaks, you would realize that most of it is because of wishing kind of, you know, attacks. These are not large scale attacks. These are syndicated attacks also, but these basically leverage the ignorance of the customers or their willingness to trust, right? If you look at data breaches, those are few and far between. And of course, those will continue to happen, but that's a very different ballgame altogether. So we at Razorpay, and I'm sure, you know, everybody else in the ecosystem, all the big players, we follow PCI DSS and all other data security standards. So there is nothing for the consumer or the merchant to fear. However, customer awareness, you know, that's a topic on which, you know, both Sunil as well as Karthik, you know, touched upon. And that's something which has been our bane in India for a very long period of time. And I don't think there is, again, any easy way of getting that achieved. All of us have a responsibility there. All of us, starting right from, let's say, RBI and the government, to all of us participants in the ecosystem, we have that responsibility on us to try and make. So it can be done in two ways. One is, of course, you go and, you know, disseminate information and you sort of teach and train people. The other one is to make, is to create an experience which is absolutely seamless and simple to adopt, but is very, very safe and secure. So something which is intuitive, where people do not have any chance of going wrong, right? They do all the steps the way intuitively anybody would do. However, they don't have to worry about the safety, security, all of that magic happens in the background. That's something that we attempt to do, right? Whether it's, you know, reading your OTP, whether it's, you know, saving your card and then making it available to you every time you use it on the same device, etc. Some of those actions or some of those solutions are a step in that direction to make sure that the onus of maintaining safety and security is more on entities like us rather than on the customer. However, yes, awareness is something that needs to continue to be built. I think till we have achieved a certain critical mass where everyone understands that sensitive information does not should not be shared with you know, so-called bank representatives who pose as bank representatives. Once we have achieved that level of awareness amongst our customers, I think we will have a very safe payment ecosystem in India.
Okay, Mahesh, you wanted to say something, and yeah. You know, go on, please.
It's because it's interesting what Amitabh just said. You know, on security is something that's always very paramount for any financial transactions, and the acceptance of the trust factor that you do across on it. I think one area that is completely, as yet, very low-balled is the risk management framework of a lot of banks who are now into this kind of digital transactions, right? I think there is a lot that banks have to mature in their process in terms of managing and delivering risk management, which is not just about a security on the fly, but it is about the overall transaction analysis and where and how things get done. I think that entire intelligence and the layering across in terms of the rules and the AI put across on top of it, today that is missing. And the kind of transactions, the way you analyze the transactions, the way you analyze the patterns, the way you respond to certain set of alerts that come in, I think today there is still a lot of gap there. So which means while you may protect a lot on the front end, to be able to create a much more viable proposition, to make it much more secure, it's about the issuing side. At the end of the day, the issuing side of the transaction needs to be far more mature. I think that maturity curve is still to be built. Because at the end of the day, if any issuer, which is predominantly as yet a bank and now growingly into the non-banking segment, the amount of investment they do there is as yet less. And more than the investment, it was the practice. Yeah. It's a practice.
Correct.
Practice as yet is not given that kind of importance. So I think that's very critical, because the moment any kind of, the customer should say that, you know what, I know my bank, and if I've transacted and something is going wrong, can I proactively block it for a particular reason, or can I proactively inform or hold it before things go out of hand? I think those levels of capabilities need to add on. Which I think will add to what Amitabh just said today.
No, it's interesting you added that point because, you know, all the banks that I speak to, all the big banks in India, they say that they are helping startups, they are making it easy. But you're right, in the payment space, if the issuing banks don't spend on the technology to make the experience better, I think it is a problem. I don't know why they don't want to talk about it. Karthik, you wanted to say something? Karthik, Sunil, about security and what and
security is going to be a responsibility for all players in the ecosystem that touch a transaction, right? Whether it's the issuing bank, whether it's TPAPs like us, it's literally every one of us has to invest in it. I mean, all of us, Amitabh talked about a few things on Razorpay, whether it's us or other D2C oriented payment apps, we've all invested significant amount of effort, engineering effort on detecting and resolving fraud. Right, social engineering, fraud,
absolutely.
Fraud. There's just a lot of it, and I think it's just every player in that ecosystem needs to do that, and that's the only way the entire trust equation can be solved.
Yes, Ben. Well said. Sunil, any thoughts on this quickly?
So basically, on security side, there are two aspects to it, and probably India is the most evolved anywhere in the world when it comes to security of transaction, be it backend or be it regulated. Look at it that, you know, just now, I think last few months, the RBI has rolled out that every card needs to be enabled explicitly by the customer. If he is not using the transaction for international transaction, it needs to be disabled. And the mobile banking application must have that enabled and enablement and disablement. Not only that, ATM withdrawal, online transaction, international transaction, and these are the four methods where you are able to do your daily limit, your peak limit, and your monthly limit. All this can be done by a customer based on that. So that is what regulation has imposed. And probably it is the very, very, I would say, welcome sign in terms of bringing that trust on the transaction, because your card. So as Amitabh was telling that, you know, India has gone ahead with security of transaction much ahead of all other peers world over, because two-factor authentication was brought by India first. And even in US today, many sites do not have two-factor authentication.
Agree.
You have a credit card, and that credit card, if you don't disable for international transaction, you will have a card being compromised somewhere, and you can have an international transaction being enabled. So some of these things have even regulators have brought. And what Mahesh mentioned, that banks need to also take proactive actions in terms of some of the taking help of some of the fintech to bring, because everything cannot be done by core banking, because that, you know, everything needs to be done inside core banking. So if you want to do AML, you want to do fraud analysis, everything needs to happen inside core banking, and that's how they need to do. Probably that's where I think some mindset need to change, that there are modules available with fintech which can proactively give such, I would say, guidance to a risk or fraud department of the company, and you can proactively or reactively also enable, disable such transactions. That is where I think the security aspect, this is probably, again, India is ahead of many other countries.
Okay, interesting. In the next question, in the interest of time, I'm going to combine two questions because they're related to each other. And I'm going to start with Mahesh. It's about these global trends that are happening in terms of technology. And obviously, as a fintech leader, India is obviously leading there. UPI can be exported to other countries. I heard the US government's talking to us, and that's the news. But what are some of the trends? Because I see Karthik's company, PhonePe has experimented a lot with, you know, these calculators for SMBs, the intelligent calculators. Amitabh's company has got something called Neo Banking. And today contactless payments have gone to a wristwatch and all that. So in terms of payments, Mahesh, what are some of the innovations that have happened globally? What is happening globally in each country that you notice? And then I'll segue into Amitabh, Karthik, and probably Sunil can sum up all these trends. And in between, you can also advise a lot of these fintech startups on disruption in India with these trends. Go on, Mahesh.
Yeah, I think the way I look at it is, India is definitely leading in terms of some of the innovation on payments. I can say that. And now some of our surveys have really called out, whether it is the flavors of fast, where now we are probably leapfrogging in terms of the real-time payments, whether it's PACE survey, which talks about the adoption of payments, digital payments. Mm-hmm. Having said that, as a response to your question, I've given that I have the remit from outside of the US, right from Europe to Australia. Each country is reacting and responding very differently to this whole challenge, right? If you look at the UK, they're still probably adopting in pieces. Now they went ahead with faster payments, which they believed was a great segue, but now they're changing that game plan. Their adoption they're still pretty much on the cards. Cards infrastructure is still probably big. They're starting to grow on the online infrastructure pretty much, but it is obviously limited in the way they look at it, right? The change, the speed of change is probably slower in the Europe and in the UK, right? You start to go towards the east part from India side. I think the Asia side, there are pockets of Asian communities which are starting to adopt. And you're right when you talk about some of the UPI stories and everything getting pulled into those environments. If not direct, at least indirectly, there is a lot of asks for innovation there. We've seen in places like Thailand, we've seen in places like Philippines, which are pretty much akin to the way India behaves, especially Philippines, where the government is now seeding the ask to get to adopt digital payments. I wouldn't say they are there in the journey as yet, but there is a huge opportunity. And typically the SMB community, the Kirana community, the sari stores, as they call it there, now the adoption and the change is pretty rapid there. They're trying to move in that direction. Had COVID and the pandemic not come in, probably they would have started in their journey much faster. They're still not there. Their infrastructure is still coming up the curve is the way I look at it. Mm-hmm. Australia has gone well, but Australia has again gone very well in terms of digital adoption, especially on the mobile side. I think that they have pretty limited infrastructure in terms because of the way where they are located. But otherwise, in terms of adoption, they're pretty good. They're expensive. The propositions are expensive, but in terms of adoption, the thing is pretty good. So the way I look at it, it's fairly mixed bag. But there is quite a bit of innovations happening. And you know, it's very interesting. Recently, Japan, for example, if you look at Japan, interesting, we always, you know they probably export a lot of technology. But I was very impressed to see that we've made some very big segues there in terms of enabling digital payments. And now they predominantly are, the government is pushing all the merchants to move away from digital, from cash to digital. And they have a growth story over the next, I would say, 3 years, 3 to 5 years, where they're wanting to take out cash by close to about 45-50%. And some very innovative, we've enabled some very innovative capabilities there, which is the ring, right? Which, the ring is now caught a fancy there. We've seen some, and with the Olympics expected over the next year, contactless payments using ring is picking up. So it was very interesting, and the kind of acceleration they're looking at is very because of the acceptance and the infrastructure. So it is very mixed bag. Everyone is on a journey, but the pace of the journey is different. The flavor of that journey in terms of adoption is different. Not everyone has a credit culture. Most of the Asian countries drive on a debit culture. Most of the Asian countries are adopting the real-time payments much faster than what you would see on the card-based payments. That's a very interesting trend you can see. So if you look at a mobile-based, if you make a real-time payment on using that infrastructure, I think the adoption is faster. Which is not the case on the Western side. So you will see that difference and to how Karthik had once said, at the end of the day, if your experience says, I want to make a payment from A to B, how that payment is made, whether you use my direct to account, whether you use a card, virtual card in the app, or whether you use a device which is like a ring or for your palm, whichever way with secure authentication, the adoption will start taking place. The acceleration will come in where I believe the government lends that support to some of these acquiring infrastructures. So yes, net, each one is in a different path. That's what I'm seeing. And we are seeing what we do in one place, can it be exported? It can be passported. We call the word passport. Can you passport it across? Yes, you can. But the passporting is many a times limited. the use case doesn't really, the payments flow doesn't nearly get fully accepted. So we see some changes that need to be done out there. So it's interesting. I think a mixed bag, but very interesting journey that we see ourselves. And it is reflective of some of the, I would say, studies and everything that we do ourselves.
Absolutely. And in this mixed bag, how do you advise Indian startups to become like a Razorpay or a PhonePe?
I think it's best to ask them. They're there. They are the people who've really changed the game, and I'm kudos to the team. And thing is, so I would say we've starting to, we have unicorns out here. Now the unicorns are effectively, and they've grown so rapidly, it becomes very proud. When you go across and you talk, you say, you know what, come over, we can probably give you that technology faster than what you do there, right? And the speed at which we change, the speed at which out here we change, create technology and implement is possibly something that others are starting to realize, the agility. Sometimes we don't go through we don't adopt a waterfall approach, we adopt an agile approach. And that probably, I believe, is the game for it. And
I agree with you.
So I would say that it's kudos to the whole fintech ecosystem, but it is time to explore beyond and to go and to create those capabilities beyond India. And we are someone whom I'm sure we've been talking to quite a few to see how do we take this across to the other.
Yeah. Okay, Amitabh, trends versus opportunity and advice to startups. How do we go about it?
So, you spoke about wearables, right? The moment you took that square or rather the rectangle shape out of the equation, then, you had the whole playground to yourself, right? So earlier, since there was a magnetic stripe at the back of the plastic, that's why the reader also needed to be, made in a certain way, slots had to be created. Mm. As you move more and more towards contactless, then form factor becomes completely, I would say, boundaryless in a sense, right? So whether it's rings, whether it's, fobs, bracelets, other wearables, all of those things, because you basically need to embed the chip, which needs to be read by the device. And, you can just let your imagination fly on how you wish to do it. Closer home, something which probably escapes attention is the FASTag, right? I mean, that's also a payment device, which is read by a reader, right? And
you don't have to wait in line anymore. Absolutely. The car's waiting long hours.
It's just stuck on your windscreen and, you just drive past. So that's another form. If you look at smart payment devices, right, or smart home appliances, right, those also, are probably in a slightly different genre, but more or less in the same category, where, a smart refrigerator would see when your stocks need to be replenished, and there is a payment system which will automatically get activated, and a smart washer which will do the load. So there is no end to it, but the point being that the moment you take it remote and the moment you don't have to have a face-to-face interaction, sky's the limit in terms of how creative you can get. And Mahesh was talking about the Olympic Games next year. Fingers crossed, we all hope they happen peacefully. So those are events which obviously lead you to doing some of these things. Mobile phones, we are talking about phone, watches and all of those things, but something which is likely to become ubiquitous, and I just want to take a couple of minutes to talk about it. See, one of the things which is going to drive contactless payments, or in fact a very different payment experience from the consumer side in the days to come, is the whole convergence. Right, the convergence of, today if you look at the kind of devices which are coming up, and Sunil talked about SoftPOS, I think that industry itself is going through a fairly massive disruption. There are already a few prototypes out where every mobile phone can technically become a payment acceptance device. Now imagine, versus a 5 or 6 million, that debate suddenly becomes irrelevant, because you may probably have 200 million or 300 million devices which can accept payments. Practically every device can become an acceptance device. We're not too far from there. Similarly, if you look at tokenization, right, very, very important concept. Tokenization is not limited only to cards. Frankly speaking, you can use a mobile device to carry your, card token, or you can possibly keep the token in the cloud. However, the point is, when you're tokenizing, you can target practically any instrument to be tokenized. I mean, UPI, frankly, is a token of the bank account, right? In a similar manner, the bank account can be tokenized in many other ways. Or let's say a wallet, which itself probably is a token, can also be tokenized. So tokenization, again, you know, pushes boundaries in manners which I've never seen before. Now, yeah. Think of a scenario where 2 years, 3 years, 4 years from now, when the adoption of smartphones becomes reaches a critical mass, may become 60, 70, 80%, and these mobile phones, smartphones are in the 5,000-6,000 range, which say a lot many more people are able to sort of, you know, afford. Using that phone, depending on where you are, if you are, you know, going in a rush to catch the morning train, you will tap. If you are at a store where you want to break the queue, you already know what you have to buy, you will just open the app and you will make the payment there. You want to do a P2P, you will do that. If you are at a store which is unmanned, you will probably do a QR. So depending on your use case, depending on the the shopping environment, you will choose what to do. But the delivery will be through the same maybe device, right? Which will create some sort of a uniform or a converged kind of, you know, omni-channel experience.
Yes.
For you. That's yes. Where we are headed very, very clearly, right? It's a matter of time. Or let's say there will be merchant tokens where, I mean, some of these things are not even approved by the regulator, but I'm hoping that at some point in time, we will, some of these will see the light of the day where you don't even need to worry. You have a secure token of your card, you know, stored with your merchant or with your payment aggregator, and it's not your real card credentials. So you never have to worry about security at all. Even if somebody were to steal those credentials, they can do nothing about it. I mean, they can do nothing with it. So that's the safety security aspect, and that's how, you know, it's lending itself to different types of, say, instruments, and it's kind of blending with your everyday use items, you know, phones, watch, whatever you typically see people, you know, carrying with them when they step out of their homes. All of those will, over time, become smart. The important operating word here being they need to also be fashionable, right? I mean, if it's wires hanging or if something which is in your face, it's not going to work. It has to be like somewhere in the background, right? Nicely hidden.
Yeah, we'll probably not have these wires anymore.
Absolutely.
For sure.
It has to look nice. Coming to the fintech side, I mean, of course, I mean, look at Razorpay. Ours is a story of being completely focused on solving a problem which was very real, which existed for a long time and which we deeply believed in, which is to democratize payments for the small, medium enterprises, for the smaller businesses in the country, right? You know, our founders, when they started this company, it was born out of their own experience of, experiencing broken payments, the fact that nobody was willing to give them a corporate card as they were a small business, nobody was willing to lend, no bank was willing to initially partner with us. So the burning desire and the sharp focus was on making sure that banking services, not just payments, but payouts, you know, a whole lot of other things that you do with your current account, right? All of that should be brought in an easy to use, tech enabled form for the average business, for the business which is not large scale, which is small to medium scale. And that has not wavered. In the last 6 years, we have not moved away from that at all. I mean, whatever we do is driven by that philosophy, is driven by, that desire. And we have always made sure that we think of the customer first and then then anyone else.
Okay.
So my only advice to the budding entrepreneurs and the fintech companies would be that they need to stay true and completely wedded to their dream, their passion, what drives their enterprise, right? And make sure that their workforce, people who join them in the journey, also get aligned culturally to the same dream, to the same passion, to the same target. For them, I think they could not have been a better time than now. Think about it, the Reserve Bank finally is recognizing entities like us, is going to license, payment aggregators. There are a whole host of new platforms coming, which are going to democratize data, access to data, and therefore which will lead to access to credit and a whole lot of other banking services, right? So I think the environment is absolutely ideal. It's absolutely ripe. In terms of opportunity, I mean, something that we've been talking about endlessly about India, right? The opportunity is just endless. The cash displacement or digitization opportunity is humongous. It's way more than what any one of us individually or with our own efforts can ever tap. So there is space for more people to come in. There is space for all of us to, you know, together grow this ecosystem. The last piece is that the same technology, I mean, Mahesh spoke about passporting it. Totally agree with him. You know, the nature of these businesses across the world is very similar. Their needs are similar, their challenges are similar. So once you've proven it here in India, and once it's adopted well in India, taking it outside the Indian borders and, you know, getting it adopted outside, we feel is, you know, is should be quite viable. So that's the other opportunity which obviously is in front of us, as well as all the new guys who are going to be entering.
You know, somebody once told me that you can only do two things in life, either consume or sell, okay? And I'm sure that on the consumption side, we're all sorted and our lives will be on the phone and therefore phone pay. And I think, Karthik, with the innovations that you guys are making, you'll perhaps be a super app where everything will happen on phone pay, right? And that's, I mean, that's the trend that I see. But thoughts, I mean, going on from Amitabh's topic, you know, opportunities for you, you know, advice to entrepreneurs, what's happening in the PhonePe ecosystem in terms of innovation.
Sure. So let me actually try and give some examples over and above what Amitabh and Mahesh already pointed out, because I do agree with a lot of the trends they mentioned. And I'll try and give some examples that I think will be unique to India. So I think the first thing is, when you think about getting 1 billion Indians to do digital payments, that is a problem unique to India. I know China has already been there, but India has certain demographics that are very different. And I think that will require innovation by its own. And I'll give some examples. Product design has to be super simple. If you're going from the current, say, 250, 300 million to 1 billion, it has to be super simple. And I think a key portion of that may be voice and vernacular. And India is very unique in that context. And I think there's going to be some innovation on vernacular voice, especially as it gets integrated into digital payments. I think the other thing would be actually going down the pyramid, and not just wearables, but also getting digital payments into a feature phone. There's no reason, I think Sunil also mentioned, there's no reason you need a 4G connection. You should be able to do a digital payment over SMS. So I think there's going to be some really good innovation on just broadening the base of digital payments to 1 billion Indians, which will require voice, vernacular, and even things like SMS and feature phone based payments. The second, I think, innovation is going to come in how we shop. We are, again, unique in our Kirana relationship. Very few countries are like us, where the primary relationship is with a small store down the corner. And I think the whole way in which we discover Kirana stores nearby, how we engage with them, and ultimately how we pay and repeat with them, is going to be very different 5 years from now versus today. And I think a lot of us in the ecosystem are going to play a role in that, in how shopping is going to get transformed. And I don't just mean e-commerce, I actually mean the very nature of shopping, especially with your Kiranas, and we talked about digitization earlier. And I think there's going to be a lot of innovation on that space, whether it's on discovering local stores near you, engaging with them, ordering with them, paying to them, all of that. And then the third, I think, is going to be on financial services. And I mentioned insurance and mutual funds in the past. But as we all know, these products have been traditionally sold and not bought. You also mentioned, you know, people can either only sell or consume. Financial services products, insurance and mutual funds, I think one of the key reasons, one of the key things that will actually drive adoption of these things is that they become products that are very simple to understand, bite-sized, things that, you know, you can explain to the average Joe on the street, and then they should be able to. And I think, again, we all have a role to play to drive financial services penetration in India. It is very, very low. And I think all of us have that role to drive up the penetration. And the only way that will happen is through conscious choices of making products very simple. Now, going to the other question you asked, which is advice for fintech folks or fintech entrepreneurs, I think broadly I would say three things. The first, and many people use this word MVP, minimal viable product, but I think what's underlying that is this ability and appetite to fail really fast. I think entrepreneurs have to iterate really quickly, find out what really works, and more importantly, what doesn't work, right? And really come down to that MVP after failing many times. And I think that's really requires iteration at very quick speed. The second is, once you know what's working, you have to have the appetite to go all in and go gangbusters in scaling it up. Of course, after knowing that your systems can scale. So you don't want to start scaling before you know your systems are designed for scale, but you have to have the appetite to go big. And then the third, once you go big, I think what most people realize is you can get new customers, but what really matters is your repeat customers. So I would advise folks that once they're scaling, really focus on your repeat customers, because people, you don't get repeats. You can buy new customers, but you can't buy repeats. And really have to focus on your repeats and make sure you track that and make sure that's working, because unless that's proven, you're not, you know, adding value to anybody's life.
So you can't, you have to stay and listen, stay grounded and listen to your customers at every given point of time. That's what brings a valuable startup. I agree with you completely. So then summing up, this has been such a fascinating journey. I mean, this, I'm sure 1 hour is not enough for the discussion, because we talked about SMBs, contactors, we talked about kiranas and contactors, we talked about the relationship between, you know, how state, citizen, and businesses will coexist and converge. It's a new form of polity that's forming here. And probably some sociologists should do some research on this, you know. And so on that note, right, there's big disruption. FinTech, I mean, Yuval Noah Harari says only cash is the only thing that unifies human beings. And I would say FinTech will further take them to the next level, right, of working together. Your thoughts on the disruption and what advice would you give to startups? And Mahesh, you could give the closing note to everybody. Go on.
Yeah. So I think if you look at India being a very, very peculiar country, where unlike US, UK, or Australia that Mahesh talked about, you have UPI, you have Bharat QR code, and thank God, now RBI said only Bharat QR code and UPI, no more proprietary. You have those two. Then you have Aadhaar Pay, then you have debit cards, then you have tokenized, and then you have all kinds of other payments like Soundwave and all that Karthik was talking about. All of them, what are they doing? They are hitting and debiting a bank account.
Yes.
So while NPCI has put a cap of 30% to provide level playing field, so-called level playing field, etc. Also, back of their mind, they need to also, the banks, I would not say NPCI, banks need to scale up their core banking system. Because core banking system historically was never meant for micropayments. I used to say that payments is bankers' Friday afternoon job. So typically they are only interested in lending and deposits, and that's where most of the balance sheet is being mined. But the moment you talk about micropayments, and then suddenly you have all these whole form factor agnostic payments coming, all hitting the bank account, you need to scale up the core banking and make sure that it becomes scalable. And more than FinTech being scalable, I would say core banking needs to be scalable, because suddenly you will have all these payments. The moment you go from Karthik's 150 million to 250 million or 300 million, imagine the amount of debits that will happen on core banking for those customers, because they will be doing microtransactions. And that will really create a major scaling problem on core banking of the bank itself. So prepaid could be one answer, or scaling up the core banking itself is an answer. So there are enough innovation available. So the advice to FinTech first is that, you know, there is enough innovation still available for growing from the current 150 million customer to, let's say, 400 million customer. And you have to solve a problem. That is the only way a FinTech will be successful, besides what just Karthik mentioned, that, you know, you need to scale, you need to drive, you need to have passion, and you need to do all those things. In terms of making sure that, you know, this particular platform can scale globally, yes, it will. Because if you look at it, many of you are from Bombay, isn't it? And you must have gone to Hirapanna market. And if you go to Hirapanna market, you know, ask anything you ask in Hirapanna, the guy will say, I have it. Now, even if he doesn't have it, he has it. Because the entire shopping complex in Hirapanna is his shopping complex. So he will go to the next guy, get that good, and there is an agreement ki whosoever is doing the sale, that will guy will get the lion's share of the profit, the rest will be shared between the two. So now, if you are not allowing a customer for the goods that are not in your shop, and you are not letting that customer go out, if this happens in Europe, he will say, no, I don't have it. You go to the other shop. But in Hirapanna, you don't allow that to happen. So imagine, can you say that you will only accept QR code? Or can you say you will only accept cards? Or can you say you will only accept UPI? No. The India, our country is such that you have to bring a payment system which is form factor agnostic, because you will have all kinds of customers with all kinds of preferences. And therefore, if the technology works in India with this kind of complexity, this can be scaled up anywhere in the world. whether it's Italy or anywhere else. So you have to first make sure that works here and it has been proven. All these technology coexist and work in India and you have single solution. So what solution has not happened yet, which somewhere I think Mahesh talked in the beginning. Retailer is not interested in settlement of QR code separately, Aadhaar Pay separately, debit card separately.
Single reconciliation.
So single settlement and reconciliation. And right now you have QR codes being plastered all over the place. So you have QR codes. So imagine 5 years back you had ICICI Bank POS terminal, ICICI Bank POS terminal, SBI POS terminal. Now that has been replaced by QR codes. So effectively in the urban, there is an overcrowding of digital payment ecosystem. Whereas category 3, 4, 5, 6 town, typically you have 1 or 2 maximum. It does not have more than 1 or 2. So you have a huge scope to grow beyond 150 million customers. And the opportunity for fintech, both in India and then to also take it outside India, is immense. So that's what I would say.
No, that's amazing. Mahesh, for you to give the closing now, I think this convergence, fintech is going to be the center of your entertainment, your education. It's going to be the center at your work. It's going to be everything, right? And this coexistence is very important for financial settlement and reconciliation. Your closing thoughts, and thank you for getting this panel together. It was so knowledgeable. Over to you, Mike.
Thank you, Ray. Hey, thank you, everyone. I should start by thanking this panelists for really coming together at a short notice, I would say, and in a very, very entertaining conversation. And I do hope a lot of people who see this will benefit from it. That's most important. I think key areas that we have discussed about, more importantly, around the fact that how do we innovate around a business problem, around on the customer experience, yes, around the problem that we solve for. That's very critical. The other thing is all about the scale that we can operate. And I like Karthik when he said that any startup needs to test, that is fail fast and come back. And once it is run, to integrate to what Sunil and Amitabh all talked about, is about the scaling. And scaling has to be always done with keeping in mind the risk appetite that one can take, both in the front end as well as in the back end. So obviously, we see there is going to be, the opportunities are immense. We just scratched the surface at this moment in time. You will see failures coming through. So you will see that there'll be a lot of Me Too opportunities coming up, but not really being able to scale and going off. But anyone who rightfully is in a position to be able to identify the right problem statement and bring solutions for that, I think it's absolutely, the open arms will be welcomed across. So that's my 2-3 areas. And last but not the least is about, no, I think I'm very proud of being an Indian here amongst all of you here in terms of being one of the fintechs and taking, passporting some capabilities across. I think that's something which we have to showcase to the whole world. We've already done a few big ones. But to me, to be able to take it across the globe where the opportunities exist, right, and go and change the game there, I think is going to be what I would love to see. That's what, when I travel, every time I say, India has this, India has that, but it's just you don't take it there. So I think there's a huge opportunity for us to export our talent, not just talent, but also the capabilities that we have developed. And that's the way I would look at it. So thank you. Thank you, team, once again. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. And for those of you who are watching this, it's not the end of the road. Send me the questions. I'm going to get the panelists to answer it, especially you startups have these burning questions. I'll get Amitabh, Karthik to answer anything around regulatory capital and approaching corporate. I'll get Mahesh and Sunil to come in and talk about it too. So thank you very much once again. And contactless payments is the future. And post-pandemic world is all about staying innovative. The innovation cycle is shortened. And you guys, the startups, are going to go change the world, make it better. Thank you, Sunil, Karthik, Amitabh. Thank you, Mahesh. I'll see you all soon. Thank you.